generation of parallel postulate. In particular, the next thing we are going to do is to prove the big task that stands ahead of us, is to prove that the angle sum of a triangle equal to two right angles implies the Euclidean parallel postulate. So it is one of the statements that can be a replacement for Euclidean parallel postulate in addition to neutral geometry to obtain the Euclidean geometry. And we started with considering the continuity. Continuity for segments first, so it's called first continuity axiom. It's also called Archimedes principle. Which sounds very, very easy and natural for any segments A and B. There exists number n such that n A is less than n B. So A can be covered by a few smaller segments, no matter how small they are and how huge the segment A is. Or we will often use it in this context. Or for any segments AB, there exists number n such that if I divide segment A into sufficient number of parts, each part will be smaller than given segment B. A over n is less than B. And I will write in brackets because it's not essential, but this is a context in which we apply this principle. No matter how great is A and how small is segment B. Even if B is a very small segment and A is huge, you divide in sufficiently large number of parts, each part will be lesser than small segment B. Let's prove that a similar statement holds for angles. Theorem. For any angles alpha and epsilon, there exists number n such that alpha is less than n epsilon. And again, I will write in brackets, no matter how great is alpha and how small is epsilon. We are actually going to consider triangles and various polygons, so it would be enough for our purpose to consider alpha being acute and obtuse. Note if alpha is obtuse, then alpha over 2 is acute, right? Alpha divided, bisected obtuse angle is acute angle, right? If angle is less than 2 right angles, half of it is less than right angle. So will be enough. So that's our knot. So let's prove this theorem. Let's prove this theorem. I will start with reminding you a result that we proved already a few times in various contexts. And in particular, we considered it as a problem of dividing the opposite side of a triangle by a bisector. So I will say lemma. We will need this lemma. Lemma is about the following, that if you have a triangle, let's say A, B, C, in which C is the greatest angle, or it's enough for our purpose that AB is greater than AC. But in this particular context, if C is a greater angle, it's clear that AB is the greatest side in the triangle. Yes? If angle C in triangle ABC is obtuse or right, in reality you don't need it. It would be enough to say that it is the greatest angle in triangle. And AD is a bisector of angle A, then, so these two angles are congruent. Then CD is less than DB. As I said, we can prove a more general result. You can prove a more general result without any trouble. It's just the same method. But I just need this context. More general, if AB is greater than AC, then it follows CD is less than DB. And we prove this result, it's true in neutral geometry. We didn't even need the Archimedes axiom or anything for this, just all we need is the exterior angle theorem. So I will assume this lemma because we proved it in class and we considered similar problems before. If you still have doubts about it, you prove it. The whole proof is just in reflection of triangle ACD in the bisector. Prime and considering various angles associated with this division, and then you prove that the segment that stands further away from obtuse right angle DB is greater than CD. So I consider this lemma to be proved. And we use this result. Now we also agreed that it's enough to prove this theorem for an acute angle, because for an acute angle you just take twice as many segments and you can twice as many angles and you will cover it with a smaller angles. It won't be a problem. So now let's go to the proof. So what we are proving that for any angles alpha epsilon there exists number n such that n epsilon greater than alpha n. N epsilon n times epsilon greater than alpha. That's what we are proving. Let alpha be an angle in the right triangle. This is vertex B, this is vertex C, suppose this angle is alpha. Let alpha be angle A in a right triangle ABC. Let's draw the rays that form angles epsilon first with leg AC and then with each next ray. So draw a series of rays. This ray will intersect the side at the point C1. This angle is epsilon. Next one will intersect at the point C2 and this angle is also epsilon. Next one will intersect at the point, trying to make my picture realistic. Next one will intersect at the point C3, and this is also epsilon. And more, another one, C4. This is also epsilon angle, so let's draw rays AC1, AC2, AC3, AC4 and so on. Each one making angle epsilon with AC for AC1 and then each one and then making angle epsilon with the preceding ray beneath it. I will just use this to make this writing shorter. Then by lemma. AC1 can be considered AC1. Can be viewed as a bisector in triangle AC2C with with angle C being right angle, hence the segment that stands farther away from the right angle will be greater. C1, C2 is greater than C1. Similarly, we can consider next triangle in which AC2 can be viewed as a bisector, yes? And therefore this segment will be greater than the previous one. Yes? Similarly, C2, C3 is greater than C1, C2. Then we'll get the sequence. CK minus 1 is greater than CK minus 1, CK minus 2, greater than, and so on, greater than C1, C2, C1, or C1, C2, CK plus 1 will be greater than CK minus 1 CK. So each next segment will be greater. C3, C4 will be greater than C2, greater than C1, C2, greater than C1. So the sum of this segment plus this, plus this, plus this, if I take up to Cn, will be greater than if I take n times CC1. So the segment CC1 plus C1, C2 plus C2, C3 plus, and so on, plus Cn minus 1 Cn will be greater than n times, if I take CC1 n times, yes, it will be greater than CC1 plus CC1 plus CC1 n times, which is n times CC1. Right? Now, choose such n that n capital times CC1 is greater than CB. Then point CN will be lying above point B. Then CCN will be greater than CB. If now I join K with this point C and capital, CCN capital is greater than CB. This is point B. Therefore, the whole triangle ABC will be contained in triangle CNAC. Therefore, angle CNAC, which is equal to N times epsilon, right? Because each time we draw this ray at an epsilon to the previous ray. Angle CNAC is greater than angle BAC, which means n times times epsilon is greater than alpha, quod erat demonstrandum. Right? In case when alpha is obtuse, we can prove similarly, and epsilon is greater than alpha over 2. So 2n times epsilon will be greater than alpha. So any angle, whether acute or obtuse, can be covered with a few smaller angles. Or again, for any angles alpha epsilon, there exist number n such that when alpha is divided by this sufficiently large number, it's getting smaller than epsilon. And we will need this in our further proofs. Now we are ready to prove the theorem that we are going to prove. What we proved right now is the continuity property for angles. Why did we not postulate it? Because it follows from the continuity property for segments, which is more fundamental. We will use it many times. You will see you will have to use it when introducing measurements for straight segments. You will use the Archimedes continuity principle again. So now the theorem, in assumptions of neutral geometry, and Archimedes principle, or Archimedes axiom, angle sum of any triangle congruent to two right angles implies the Euclidean, and we will prove it for playfairs. We know their equivalent, Playfair's parallel postulate. The proof. So what do we know? We are given angle sum, we mean of course integer angle sum. Yes, we often say in angle sum of a triangle, we always mean integer angle sum of any triangle is two right angles. We are going to prove. We will prove that there exist not more exactly one or not more than one, not more than one line parallel to a given line L through an exterior point of L. So that will be our proof. wrote the formulation of theorem, I repeated many times already. We will just use the whole board because we will need a big and very clear picture. The greater and more and the clearer is our diagram, the easier it is to see things. Right? That's why I hope on the next exam we will all draw huge and very clear diagrams. So suppose there is a certain line L and there is an exterior point A and I will say let A be an exterior point of line A. Let's draw a perpendicular from A onto A. In the foot of the perpendicular, I will denote B. Let AB is perpendicular to L, B lying on A. Through A, I will draw a line perpendicular to AB. A, draw line M perpendicular to AB. Then, as we know, we proved it. We proved the existence of parallel lines. This line M, then M is parallel A. Let's prove that any other line through A is not parallel to A. Are we going to prove it? By contradiction. We will prove it by contradiction or by reduction ad absurdum. So suppose there is a line that is parallel to L, and this line is not perpendicular to AB. So it is different from M. If it's not perpendicular to AB, it can make on one side an acute angle with AB, on the other side it will make obtuse angle, right? It will not be a right angle like here. So I will draw the half plane in which this line makes an acute angle with AB. We give a name to this line. No. I will give it a name. Suppose this is line K. It's a good name for a line. And I will say proof by reduction ad absurdum. Suppose K is another line parallel to L. is not perpendicular to AB. Consider the half plane. Consider the, in my picture, it's right half plane. Right half plane. Where K makes an acute angle with AB, right? On one side it will be acute angle, on the other side it will be obtuse angle. I want to consider this half plane. So all I'm going to do in the future will be all the constructions will be in this half plane. My construction will be like this. I have to erase this. So, continue writing. It's a very typical proof for when we use continuity.